First case to come before us this morning is In Re ASZSZSZSZCS and AS. Ordinarily, I'd be telling you both sides have 15 minutes to argue, but I think you can tell that the state has waived oral argument this morning, so you will have 15 minutes. Please don't use the names of victims or minors, as this is being recorded and will be posted on the court's YouTube channel. We've read the briefs. We're ready to proceed when you are. Please do. Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honors. My name is Eric Hall. I represent the appellant, Terry Smith, in this case. It's the tragic case, troubling case. The appellant lost custody of seven children in this matter. The case went to full hearing in front of Judge Letitia Miles. I read the appellee brief, and in my brief, I focused on, I think, what I thought were the important things, the positive things that the appellant had done in the case. The issue is that the court, the decision was against the manifest weight of the evidence, and also it wasn't clear and convincing evidence to support the finding of permanent custody for these seven children. If you look at the positive things in this case, the appellant was engaged in case plan services and was working toward unification. Okay, so this wasn't a case where they were resistant to case plan services, which are some cases. Regarding the wishes and desires of the children, there was a loving relationship between all the children and the mother. There was an issue in the case of housing. I mean, that was the first issue that, two issues really, that there was this allegation of these clowns chasing children with knives and the children being terrified. Although there were never any criminal charges or anything filed based on that. So it seems like there was a lot of investigation done into that, but it never resulted in any, in this matter, it wasn't the abuse. This was clearly a case of dependency, I believe. So abuse was never, there was never a finding of abuse. So that allegation seems to be mostly hearsay. By the time of the permanent custody hearing, the appellant had obtained a stable housing. She also demonstrated a willingness to engage in drug and alcohol and mental health counseling and treatment. Dr. Amy Thomas, I believe, testified to that effect during the trial. And she had also submitted clean drug screens, which that to me is one of the clear indication that she was accomplishing that part of the case plan successfully. That seems to be a struggle in a lot of these matters, where to maintain sobriety, maintain clean screens, she was able to do that. And I know this is off the record, but she's still engaged in services. So this is a person that willingly engaged in services and continues to engage in these services today. She's still working the case plan, even though it's on a completely voluntary basis.
But part of the problem with this case, according to the evidence, was that even though she worked the case plan, even though she went into classes and so forth, she wasn't really exhibiting what she learned. In other words, she wasn't parenting. She was still parenting the same way she always had.
Your Honor, that's the focus of the appellee's brief. It seems to be basically that the parenting, they didn't feel that her parenting skills were up to par, in their opinion. But I would argue that simply having difficulty in parenting alone is not grounds for taking custody from somebody. Parenting children, whether it's seven children or one child, can be difficult. I think in this case, some of the, she had limited time to look at how this parenting was deserved. It was in a supervised basis. She had very limited time in which the children were away. Then she has time with the children. It's being observed. And all of a sudden, here are all the children. They're all together. And she's got this much time, which is a very limited amount of time, to demonstrate that she can parent effectively. Those circumstances, quite frankly, really weren't, they wouldn't give the appellant a fair opportunity to show that she had parenting, that she had basically grasped some of the parenting skills that they were case plan services were requiring her to get. Under those circumstances, she has a short amount of time, and I read a lot of this. It was very chaotic. These meetings and time with the children were very chaotic. I mean, she's trying to have meals with them, trying to spend time time with them. There's seven kids. She has to spend time with each one of them. And, you know, in that short period of time, I don't think that gave me really a fair picture of what she had learned or what she was able to do. Your Honor, I just think that this case, once again, you know, it looks like that the, you know, for lack of better words, they focus mainly on parenting, her, their opinion of her parenting skills. This was a case of dependency, but I think that she showed that she had gotten herself at least up to speed on, and I think what I think the important things was clean drug screens, getting a safe housing, that was, and also the desire to work towards unification, and she exhibited that. As I said before, this is all outside the record. She's still engaged in case services plans. So
well, yeah, let's try to keep it to our record and to that point. At the point where the hearing was, when we talk about safe housing, wasn't she residing with someone who she said she would continue to reside with, who had not engaged in services and who the children did not want to reside with?
She was residing with somebody, Your Honor, that's clear. And she indicated that herself, that she was doing that. As far as the housing itself, though, there was a lot of dispute as to whether she even actually had housing in this case, and I think that was overlooked. There was a lease in this case. She was able to present that she actually had a signed lease, and there was some dispute over something about the signatures and some other things that really, when I read this, I really couldn't understand what the dispute was. I mean, she presented a lease, and it showed that she did have housing, so I don't really understand why there was this focus and dispute on whether she'd actually obtained housing. I think it was clear that she had.
I think it's because didn't they say something about it not being stable because she could be kicked out at any point?
I'm sorry, Your Honor.
It wasn't it about the stability of the housing? Because they were unsure if the if it was a lease for just the man she was living with, and if they broke up, she would have to leave. Do you have anything to say about the stability of the home?
I think that's correct, Your Honor, and I think that what my understanding was, and I really didn't see it as far as the trial itself, but it didn't seem like there was a lot of effort to really figure this out, not only on the behalf of Children's Services and GL, but also her own counsel. I think, you know, quite frankly, it was counsel's responsibility to demonstrate to the court in some manner that this was an issue that was resolved, because it seems to me one of the easier issues, if you look at all the issues that were raised by Children's, this was one of the easiest ones to resolve, the housing issue. It's basically a factual issue that either it is or it isn't, and I think that somehow both the appellee and also appellant's counsel was remiss in not getting that resolved and being able to have that as a not really a non-issue in this case, in light of all the other issues that had to be tried in this case, Your Honor. I would simply say that the trial court's decision in this case was against the manifest weight of the evidence, not supported by clear and convincing evidence. And the tragedy in this case is that, I mean, not that it's less tragic if there's one child, but this is seven children, Your Honor. And they're all ages, they run the gamut of all ages. And, you know, as far as where they're going to be and what's going to happen to them, whether they're going to stay together, that's got to be even more traumatic and tragic for the appellant in this case. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, counsel. Court will take the matter under advisement. We will issue a written decision, which will be mailed to all parties in this appeal, as well as posted on the Ohio Supreme Court website.
Thank you.